in contact with you. Promise you, we won't chase you down and make you feel bad or anything like that. Just want to let you know that we're thankful that you're in worship today. And also, if you have a prayer request or a joy that needs announcing, please write it down on a blue prayer card from the pew and put it in the offering plate during the collection time. So we have those announcements and the welcome today. Oh, Brenda, you got one? Like to apologize too for the talking, working around the mint, but I've got a little choky up thing today, so just if you'll allow me to do this, we'll probably be better. Anybody have a birthday today? Anybody? Nobody? So this was a dry week, was it? Yeah. Wow. Prayer notes. Does somebody have a joy that they want to lift up before the Lord today? Sandy?
I got to see my new great nephew. And my niece is doing great.
So this was the baby that is in vitro. Yeah, so he's definitely a beautiful miracle. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. There was a lady in the back. Carrie? Wylene, did you want to say something? Several people have asked, and they did the surgery. It was 2 weeks ago. Went to the doctor, you know, and in that interim, she is totally pain-free, totally. So the surgery resolved the entire issue of the pain. So we're thanking God for that. I'm thanking God because it's about time to start raking leaves in the yard. So we'll be working on that. If I try to make that happen, we will have prayer for my healing later on. Call to worship today says, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Let's draw near to the Lord today. Amen. Opening hymn, Make Me a Captive, Lord, page 421 in your hymn. Turn to page 738 in your hymnal and join in the reading of Psalm 1, page 738. Then be prepared for the Apostles' Creed found on page 881. Blessed are those who do not walk in the counsel of the wicked, but their delight is in the law of the Lord. They're like trees planted by streams of water that yield their fruit in season, and their leaves do not wither.
In all that they do, they prosper.
The wicked are not so, but are like chaff which the wind drives away. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous.
But the way of the wicked.
You join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So we are prepared to receive Kurt and Rhonda Eichenberger. If y'all would come up and let me go get the litany, I think. Yeah, there it is. Oh. Welcome. You have this today. Last week, we took members in the church, and it was such a weird week for me, I forgot to get it in the bulletin. And I wanted to blame it on Wendy, but it was me. but we do want to recognize Hal and Becky, and we want to recognize Paul Allen for being members joining with us. And so if you will follow with me. Dearly beloved, the church is of God and will be preserved to the end of time. It's for the conduct of worship, the due administration of his word and sacraments, for the maintenance of Christian fellowship and discipline, for the edification of believers and the conversion of the world. All of every age and station stand in need of the means of grace which it alone supplies. These persons who are coming before us for membership today have received the sacrament of baptism. They've been instructed in the teachings of the church, and now they're ready to profess publicly the faith into which they were baptized. Rhonda, Kurt, do you here in the presence of God in this congregation renew the solemn promise and vow that you made or that was made in your name at your baptism? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and pledge your allegiance to his kingdom? Do you receive and profess the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments? Do you promise according to the grace given to you to live a Christian life and always remain a faithful member of Christ's holy church? The Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Will you be loyal to New Salem Methodist Church and uphold it by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness. Church, I commend to your love and care these persons whom we this day receive into the membership of this congregation. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. We rejoice to recognize you as members of Christ's holy church And we bid you welcome to the congregation of the New Salem Methodist Church. With you, our vows to uphold it by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. Rhonda, the peace of the Lord be with you. Kurt, the peace of the Lord be with you. If you would come, church, the peace of the Lord be with you. Come and greet your new members. God for everything that he's given. Thanking the Lord for a roof over our head, shoes on our feet, food on our table, all that basic kind of give us this day our daily bread stuff. Almighty God, we thank you for your gifts to us. We thank you, God, for the ways that you feed us and house us and care for us. We thank you, Lord, for the ways that you heal us. Lord, we are thankful most of all for the sacrifice of your Son and our Savior that set us free from our sins. Lord, you made he who had no sin to become sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. We thank you for that, Lord. We pray that you would receive these gifts that we return unto you as a token of our love, as a token of our notice and our acknowledgement of you as our great God and our loving Lord. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Good morning. big one. Marshall Hunter said the Dade County fall baseball team ended up second place in the Ottawa tournament. Congratulations, Marshall. Y'all did good, buddy. So we have, Wylene has praise for her successful surgery, and I praise the Lord for that too, and we're so thankful about that. And I don't know about you, but I believe doctors are called. I don't believe that you can do what they do if you're not called. You know, I believe it's a gift that God gives. So thank you for God healing in that particular way. Judy Stanfield and Judy and Nikki Oliver are asking us to pray about the sin of pride with them. Oh, no, wait a minute. It says they have a new great-grandchild. That's what it is. Great-great-grandchild. Oh, just one great, great grandchild. Okay. If I don't quit messing with that, I ain't gonna get much older either. His name is George Marshall Wilkins, and he's very healthy. So praise the Lord for that. Praise the Lord. Somebody just put joy for answered prayer. Every once in a while, you might want to sit around and take an account. God's answered a whole lot more than we are aware of. We have prayer, asking prayer for Jason. He'll be having surgery on his right arm, and they will figure out when they'll do that later, so be praying for Jason. Marshall Rose's father passed away last night. Marshall works with Tad at Covenant College. Please pray for Marshall and his family. Angie and Ron asked to remember in your prayers for their son-in-law, Alan Clayton, for he has a possible concussion from a hit in the head by a tree. So pray for him that God would heal that. Pray for the family of Steve Combs. He was killed in a car wreck last Monday when it was. So pray for the family of Steve Combs. Pray for Josiah and Thad and his family. Josiah's grandmother died last week. So that family has, I know they've been on your prayers, been in your prayers, so pray for God's comfort. Jet has been having some very bad migraines, and he can't keep anything down. So pray for Jet that the Lord would heal that. And is it Kevin Grapper?
Yeah.
Grapper? Okay. Please pray for Kevin Grapper. He's undergoing chemo treatment. Sandy asked prayer for him. Michelle says that her dad goes to the skin doctor, to see a skin doctor, sleep centers this week. So pray for Jerry Cowns. Pray for Steve Combs. We mentioned that. Pray for Kermit Vaughn. Many of you know Kermit and Allegene Vaughn, and Kermit is in the last stages of Alzheimer's, so just pray for him, pray for his family. And so we want to pray, too, for Joe D'Agostino. He is doing chemo, and he's in the process of chemo, and he's staying in touch with me, and through me, staying in touch with you. So be a praying church. Pray for these people. And I ask you again, you know, keep your bulletin and use that prayer list on the back as a discipline for daily prayer. God does not tell us to pray for no reason at all. There is a reason behind prayer, and there's a power behind it. Remember the disciples one time were out. Jesus had sent them on mission, and somebody had brought to them a person who was possessed with spirits, and the disciples could do nothing. So the people came and said, we brought this person to your disciples, and they could not cast the spirit out. And Jesus spoke, and the spirit left. And he turned around and told his disciples, this only happens through prayer. Prayer is powerful. So pray for these people, and let's pray today. Almighty God, we lift every request to you. Lord, we hold before you every joy. Lord, as people are suffering in this world, people who are connected with this church, we pray not only that you would do something, but that you would call us to do something. Lord, help us be willing to lift a burden. Help us be willing to be a kindness. Help us be willing to be an encouragement. Lord, help us be willing to be a forgiveness. Lord, as we pray today, lifting each person that we've named to you, before you, we thank you that you sustain us in our deepest losses. You comfort us in our most profound pains. Lord, as we pray today, we lift these people up to you, but we also lift up each other. We lift up this church, that you would keep it about the main thing, that you would keep this church about doing your will in the world. Lord, we pray that you would strengthen us as a church. We pray that you would resource us as a church. We pray, God, that you would lead us as your church. We're thankful, God, for each person who's coming to join with us as a church, realizing that something very important is happening here and through here. Lord, as we pray today, we pray for our nation. We pray for our community. And we ask that your way and your will would have sway in our community, in our nation, and in our world. And we remember, Lord, to pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. I have a couple questions. First question, how many of you remember when you were a kid, kind of like right now, and you got into an argument about who was faster or who was stronger? Oh, yeah. I remember those arguments, too. I'm faster than you. I'm stronger than you, right? You remember those arguments? Well, every day at school, yes, yes, every single day, yeah. Well, that doesn't go away, okay? Throughout your entire life, there's always going to be races and people who think they're faster and stronger, and you're going to think you're faster and stronger. But, yeah, okay, what is it? You got a new what? You got new tennis shoes? Do they make you faster? Oh, yeah, yeah, okay, so... There's a story that we're reading today, okay, and the Jesus and the disciples were on a trip, okay, and the disciples were actually arguing about kind of who's faster and who's better and who's stronger, and they get to where they're going, and Jesus asks them, hey, what were you guys talking about? What were you arguing about? Well, they didn't want to tell him, because they knew they were kind of talking and arguing about something they probably didn't need to be talking and arguing about. Well, then, and this is coming up on my second question, he takes a child and he puts this child on his lap, kind of like a child like Miss Ingrid, or where's Miss Grady, where's Grady at? Or Grady, all right? Or, well, a little bit smaller than you even. Yeah, he takes a child and sets him on his lap. So I have a question. When you guys were little, not like now, when you were little, did you cook your own meals? Wait, hold on, you cooked your own meals?
I did.
What did you cook?
I cooked hamburgers.
You cooked hamburgers on a grill? Joe, hold on. Okay. Did you build your own house? Joe, did you build your own house? Oh, good. Wait. Okay, you built your own house. Did you?
My dad helped me.
Oh, your dad. You got a little help from just a little help from your dad. Yeah, but you mostly built it, right? Sure. Yeah. Hey, tighten up, Jason. Okay. So, but did you always remember to take a bath? Okay, Joe. Did you use soap? Okay. All right. But the point is, you probably, Joe, didn't really do all those things by yourself. You needed help, right? You need your parents to help you. You need your parents to feed you. Even though, Joe, I do think... Right. I don't think you cooked your own hamburgers when you were like 2. Okay. Well, I guess I believe you that you were cooking hamburgers at 2 years old. But you needed a lot of help from your parents, right? You were dependent on your parents to help you do all those things, right? Well, that's the child he put on his lap, okay? And that's a reminder to me. And what he was saying was, even though you may look at this child and you think, well, they don't have a job yet, okay? They can't drive, okay? They can't do as much as we can do as adults. Everybody can come to God, everybody. Me, you, all you guys. And you guys are an example to me to rely on my trust and my faith and my obedience and my dependence on God in my life. Because, like we talked about earlier, even in I'm an old man and I have gray beard, and even through my life, there's still people who want to race, and there's still people who want to show how strong they are. And all those things are fun, and it's a fun thing to do, but that's not the most important things in our lives, okay? Our trust and our faith and our dependence on God is the most important things in our life. And when we have those things, all that other stuff will take care of itself, okay? Does that make sense? Okay, let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for your son. Lord, please help us and strengthen our faith and our obedience and our dependence on you. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today's scripture readings are from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible. The epistle reading is from James, chapters 3 and 4. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflict. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly in order to spend what you get on your pleasures. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. As able, please stand for the gospel reading, which is from Mark chapter 9. They went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever comes to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put him among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." The word of God for the people of God.
I have avoided saying anything about the opening ceremony of the Olympics because of, you know, it's sort of supercharged kind of thing. But one of the statements about it was is that it was a it was a remembrance of a Bacchanalian feast. And just bring us up to date on that. Is that a Bacchanalian feast was such a reprehensible thing that it was outlawed by a not yet Christian Roman government in 187 AD. So even a non-Christian country didn't want anything to do with that anymore. I was watching a little YouTube thing the other day and I was trying to catch up. Did I mention the Vols won yesterday? Okay, I just. But I was watching, trying to catch up on my football and stuff like that. And ran across this little blurb about this Norse priestess. And she was tied to the stake by the evil Christians who had only recently taken over her world. And while she was tied to the stake and the evil Christians were about to burn her, she invoked the Norse gods to come into the world and destroy those evil Christians. And in a whirlwind, they came. And they destroyed those people. just said that to say this, not that I want to be a critic of those kind of things, but one of the fastest growing things, one of the fastest growing religious expressions in Western culture is a recovery of the ancient European gods. There are more witches and Wiccans registered in England now than there are Christian ministers. And the reason I said that was to say all this. Maybe it will help us see that what James wrote in this epistle to the Christian church was a brand new thing come into the world. We're used to Christianity being old hat. But for James, he's articulating a brand new value system on the face of the earth. He's articulating a brand new way of living. And he's doing this into a world of old values and old ways and old religions. Now, while we're in here, I'm going to try to stay away from the negative stuff in here because I just don't want to talk about the negative stuff. Okay? Because he's telling us all the positive and beautiful ways to live as people of a new faith on the face of the earth. And this is the time of the Christian year that we see by the paraments that it's kingdom tide. We are looking toward the coming kingdom of God. The kingdom of God has already come in those people who are baptized, but it will come to this earth, and the scriptures for kingdom tide will tell us every week about the values and the behaviors that Christianity introduced into the world, the values of a whole nother kingdom. And bypassing the temptation to state all the wrong stuff that's in James's epistle, he's just describing the way the world is as Christianity comes into it. It'd be easy to do that. It's more useful to imagine a society, a world, a kingdom of people living out a heavenly and spiritual wisdom rather than an old, earthly, avaricious wisdom. Imagine this. Imagine this not for other people. I don't know if this does this to you, but very often when I read the Bible, I think it's written for somebody else. You ever do that? I say, got somebody in mind when you read that, don't you? But guess what? It's not. It's written to me. This is not about you doing this. This is about Reece having these values. This is about Reece adopting this culture. This is about Reece being part of this kingdom. And as we hear this, imagine this for your life. None of the negative stuff. We're going to talk about the positive things that this brand new faith brought into the world. And think of it as brand new. This has not happened in the world before. Not even remotely has this happened. Imagine this from the book of James. Pure hearts. Hearts that are pure before the Lord. Submission to God purely, and love of God and for mankind. Remember, Jesus says, people said, what must I do to inherit the kingdom? He said, what did it say? He said, you must love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, thy soul, and thy mind, and you must love what? Your neighbor as yourself. That's what being pure before the Lord is. It is truly loving the Lord and loving the neighbor as ourself. It's peaceable, yearning for peace with God and working for God's peace among men, being an example of peace. That's what God envisioned for the Christian believer, to be a peacemaker and a peace bringer. Gentle, treating others with care and respect. That's what God meant for his people to be. Be a people who go through the world and respect people and care for people and treat them gently and with kindness. I don't know about you, but I've had a whole lot of people tell me the brutal truth before. I've had a whole lot of people say a whole lot of things. But you know, the people, when I think back on 74 years of living, the people who influenced me more than anybody else were people who were simply kind. Just kind to me. Kind to others. As you see it, you say, it's what I want to be. It's what I want to be. Willing to yield. That means willing to accept God's truth about things and surrendering and yielding to God. Full of mercy. Not just the little mercy, it says, but full of mercy. Full, like running over with mercy. It's like, ooh, boy, that's one we need to work on, isn't it? Mercy, full of mercy. Mercy, regard, compassion, and action without regard to somebody's unworthiness. Can I say that one more time? Because very often we're kind to people that we think deserve it. Being full of mercy doesn't have anything to do with somebody who deserves it. It's more useful for those who don't deserve it. Because I was once one who did not deserve it. And you were too. Full of mercy. Full of good fruits. Now the fruits are the works that come from the other stuff. Full of works that come from what we are in Christ. I remember working with the guys when we were building a ramp for this particular person. The sheriff's department called us and asked us if we'd build a ramp. And we were out there. It was about 2 million degrees and not really that hot, but it seemed like it was that hot. And we were out there and we were working. And a person came out on the front porch after we'd built the ramp with the walker. And she said to us, said, y'all are really good people. And one of the guys looked back at her and said, no, but we serve a really good God. Fruits. Does what we believe cause us to behave differently toward people? It's easy to say what we believe. It's much harder to live out the beliefs of Christianity. Full of fruits. Impartial. That means you treat all people with grace. Not a trace of hypocrisy, it says. Free from posturing, manipulation, and pretense. Sincere and honest. Wow. The first time that ever hit James's world. First time that ever hit anybody's world. Peacemakers, sowing peace with God. Peace, I love this. When you think about peace, people are trying to tell me that me tolerating whatever thing they want to do is causing peace. No, it's not. No, it's not. I take my definition of peace from what Martin Luther King Jr. said. He said, peace is not the absence of conflict. Peace is the presence of justice. Wow. That's something that's so important. It said, be a peacemaker. Sow peace with God. Be the person who helps people find peace and that right relationship with God. Then down there, I heard this very clearly when Wade read it. And it says, And I'm going to have to go about this in one little touch of a negative way, even though I'm going to turn it to a positive thing. It says, James says, you people are praying so that God will give you stuff that you can spend on yourself. You see? But there is a different version of prayer that James introduces in the world. This prayer that's on behalf of others. This prayer that is about what God wants done in the world, not what I want to have in the world. This prayer that's for God's kingdom to come. This prayer that acknowledges that I have needs, but I want to be about the things of God. Can you remember one sort of like that? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses to the degree that we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is kingdom and power and glory forever and ever. There's not one gimme, gimme, gimme in there. Not one. Prayerful people, people praying for the tools and abilities to do what we do for Jesus' purpose. Then it says this, draw near to God and actively resist the devil. Wow. Actively resist the devil, actively draw near to God. Draw near to God and God will draw near to you. That's a new way of living that James has articulated into a pagan world. This value system has not hit the world at all. We live in a culture that was the greatest culture on the face of the earth because it was informed by these values. And now we're trying to revert back to the other ones. The world is really working toward becoming a post-Christian world. But what we're looking at when we read the book of James is that the kingdom of God and all its values are being introduced to the world that God intends to change through the people he has called for his name. From the gospel, this big one that sometimes we find so much trouble with. Kevin brought it up. They were, if you read that gospel story, they were up in Bethsaida or somewhere else. And Jesus had taken them there away from everybody else. So he could in depth tell them about how agonizingly and horribly he was going to die. And they couldn't hear him. Because all they could think of is which one of them was the best. Then he says this one thing that the church needs to hear. If you would be great, you need to become the servant of all. That's a new thing in the world too that came with Jesus, that came with these values. With these behaviors. As we come, being a servant to God and to the smallest and the least significant of people, welcoming people in the name of Jesus. There's a lot of negative stuff in that passage that I just didn't even want to mess with. But the hope today is to imagine myself like James says. Imagine the world changing when these values came to me. Imagine myself being pure and peaceable and gentle and surrendered to God and full of mercy and full of kind works and graceful to everybody and sincere and honest, praying only for what I need to do, what God has called me to do, intentionally drawing near to God, intentionally pushing back the devil. Imagining myself as a servant, welcoming the least and the most insignificant of people into God's kingdom,
and into God's loving care. You know, heaven is going to be heaven because of who's there. Heaven is like heaven is because of the values that reign there. Heaven is going to be heaven because it is the way that God says it needs to be. We say all this, pray all this, hope for all this. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Lord, please don't let it be for the person next to me. Let it be for me. Amen.
is within 200 years, the kingdom that had crucified Christ became a Christian kingdom. And the world and the culture, the Western culture, became informed by those very values that are the kingdom of God. Go forth knowing that this way is triumphant and it is powerful. In the name of the Father and the Son.